Hello, good afternoon. Welcome to Guitarist TV. I'm Mike de Jager.
I'm Ingerlise Pope.
And this afternoon we're in a lovely little town in England called Leamington Spa. And with us is the multi-Grammy award-winning guitar player, legend, Mr. Steve Lukather.
Hello,
Stephen.
How are you, mate?
Yeah, really.
I do. Welcome to the UK. Welcome.
Yeah, I love the UK.
Yeah.
My second time, we were here in London, we did London and stuff in November. But it's nice to be back, break out of just London. That's what I'm trying to do, just
get
ease my way all the way through your wonderful country.
Yeah, yeah.
Did you choose Leamington Spa?
Did I what?
Did you choose to come to Leamington
Spa? No, I actually, my agent and my record company said, you got to just get out of London, you got to get out there. So we're just kind of, put my feet in the water out here and see where it's at. You know?
Yeah.
Here we are on St. Paddy's Day.
Yes, it is too. To all the viewers of Guitarist TV, happy St. Patrick's Day.
Yes.
We also like to take a short little opportunity to send all of our thoughts and prayers with the people of Japan.
Yeah.
Yes.
Real tragic thing going on there, and our thoughts are with you.
My dear friends, man, I have spoken to a few of my dear friends there, and they're okay, but wow, every day it just seems to become, it goes to show you how fragile life is, you know?
Yeah.
We, you know, it's one world, we're all in this together. If the whole thing goes crazy, it doesn't matter what religion or what side of the political fence you're on. Kids are kids, and people are people, and we gotta kind of look after each other. I wish we'd get more into that, but maybe we will.
Maybe we will. You never know.
Yeah, you know, we're all the same, right?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Come on. When it comes down to it.
Yes, quite right.
Now, what I wanted to know is you've been on the road for quite a while, doing
35 years.
I want to know, how different is it from touring ages ago to when you touring?
Well, I don't drink and carouse and do drugs or anything crazy. I mean, we all went through that phase. I think every musician has, you know. I mean, you hit a certain point where 35 years of Saturday nights every night, you know, kind of catch up with you, you know. And I just, for me, for my health reasons, I just decided, you know, I have two little children, I have two grown children, and for my health, I just wanted to feel good, play good, and look good, and I sort of lost my way for a while. You know, you kind of, it creeps up on you. You know, when you're 25 years old, you can beat yourself to death.
Yeah.
But I'm 53, so, you know, when I hit my 50s, it was like, oh, this is just silly at this point. You know what I mean?
Excellent.
That's good.
I used to be that guy.
You're looking mighty fine on it.
Oh, well, thank you.
You're welcome. Now, your son and your daughter both appeared on your latest album.
Yeah, my son's a real musician. He's a guitar player and singer and songwriter and producer. And my daughter, just, I drag her in there. She's kicking and screaming. She sings, but she's not a professional musician. And the little ones are just 3 and 3 months, so then we'll see where that comes.
Yep.
I just have, you know, with my son, I just left the stuff lying around the house, you know. Eventually, he was bound to pick it up, start beating on drums first, and then pick up a guitar. I gave him a drop D tuning, and said, okay, just put your fingers here. I gave him a little teeny little Marshall amp or something that's got distortion. So immediately, he was playing, like, what would be rock music immediately, because he has a natural ability, I guess, to pick up things. He was writing his own tunes within the first couple, 3 days. Of course, this is a long time ago, but I didn't have it when I was young. It was like, you know, here's a guitar with strings that far off the neck, you know, and like a $2 guitar you bought, which I still have. It's an old K guitar, acoustic guitar, with a bolt-on back.
Oh,
you know, it's literally screws screwing it in. Yeah. I got that in a copy of Meet the Beatles when I was 7 years old, and now it's a lamp in my guest room. My parents kept it for me, gave it to me, I think, when I was 21. And said, here, now that you've, like, you know, made something of yourself, why don't you remind you where you come from?
Yes.
So I've kept it ever since then. Kind of a cool memorial. These days, I mean, it's, you know, you have the internet, you can immediately start playing really well. But I mean, back then it was like nobody. When I was really young, I could play. I just had a natural ear for it. I could pick it up really quickly, and I'd always hang out with guys much older than me, and I'd learn all their stuff. And then find out, you'd always hear about a guy in the next neighborhood who could play the solo on this or whatever, and I'd always gravitate towards those people.
Yeah.
And playing bands with older guys. So my childhood was, I got in trouble early because I was always hanging out with, you know, I was like 9, 10 years old playing with guys that were 13, 14, 15.
Yeah.
You know? Normally they wouldn't let a kid hang out with them, but since I could play, teach them all the songs, my life work began.
Yes. And it was when you met Toto.
Yeah, well, I met them in high school.
Yeah.
I remember the first badass musician I really met was Mike Landau. We grew up together since we were 12 years old.
Yeah.
And he's one of my favorite guitar players in the world, just absolutely brilliant musician. But we were like the two guitar, like he was on one side, and then we ended up being in bands together and working together.
Yeah.
One of my favorite guys to work with ever, you know, but we just were always off doing different things. But
amazing.
A childhood friend, you know, and then we went to, then we jumped to school, and we met the Picaro brothers, and we both played in a band with them.
Yeah.
And then everybody, that whole thing morphed into Boz Scaggs, Toto, and studio work. And I mean, that's the really short version of what happened. But, you know, we started studying music really hard in high school. That's when it was like, okay, it's time to shit or get off the pot. You know what I mean? Learning how to read music and then studying arranging, composition, orchestration, and piano class, harmony theory, plus private guitar lessons. Wow. Plus we'd all get together and practice. We were on a million bands doing every gig you could do.
Yeah.
There used to be demo sessions where, like, you know, so you could, like, it's almost like being in minor league to go up to the major leagues, you know?
Yes.
They don't have that anymore. Everybody's got a recording studio in their house. As soon as they buy a laptop, they got garage band and a recorder, you know? So it's a different world, you know?
It is.
I mean, consequently, I mean, you know, there's a lot of virtuosity that happens at a much younger age. People have videos. Oh, that's how you do it.
Yeah.
Where we, in the old days, it's painstakingly picking up the needle.
Yeah.
Off,
so
you know, learning, like, you know, Clapton Crossroads and stuff, or Hendrix tunes and stuff like that, Jeff Beck stuff, and driving my parents crazy. Why do you have to keep playing the same thing over and over and over again? Stop it! Slowing it down. You know, I mean, really Neanderthal to what, compared to what's happening now. But, you know, hey, listen, I'm more part to it. You know?
That's amazing. I can remember when, when the hammer-on thing started happening.
Oh, I remember. I remember exactly. I was in, we were making our first record, and, you know, the first Toto record. And, you know, we heard about Van Halen. I always heard about Eddie Van Halen. I just thought Van Halen was a guy's name, Van Halen. Because, you know, we Lando and I had a band together, and we auditioned on the Sunset Strip, and they hired us, and then they found out we were underage. We were 16 years old.
Oh,
and Van Halen was the headline act. So, I just remember hearing about him, but then when I heard, you know, edit to like a few years later, we were all working in the studios.
Yes.
And then I heard about this guy, Eddie Van Halen, and then we heard the first record, and then we were in the middle, I was just doing the first album, I thought, yeah, I'm pretty good, you know, so then all of a sudden, Paige walks in with his dizzy, he goes, yeah, I got something for you here, Hot Shot. And he plays Eruption for him, and he's like, I was just like, that's it, how the fuck did you do that?
Yeah.
You know, and consequently, Ed and I were dear friends ever since then. I think in 1978 was the first time we met, and we've been bros. Him and Alex and me and the family go way, way back, and we've always worked, done things together.
Yes.
I love him to death, but the first time you heard that, it was like, it was like the first time I heard Hendrix. How did you do that?
Yes.
You know, the first time I heard Purple Haze and like the Third Stone from the Sun, I remember my parents walking in.
Yeah.
What is that? You know, it was here I'm looking, and here I am, 9 years old, 10 years old, looking at already experienced, you know.
Yeah.
And hearing it, like the Third Stone of the feedbacks, and they understand this is 1967, 60, you know, and like here I am, and my dad looks at the cover, here's the, you know, the middle of, just happens to walk in the middle part of Third Stone of the Stone with all this feedback, you'll never hear surf music again. Looks at the cover, looks at me and goes, walks out of the room, and I'm like, you know, super glued to this stuff, you know.
Yeah.
So every generation, I mean, I'm looking, where's that new guy now?
Yes.
Where's the new guy? I mean, everybody plays faster. I mean, there's a fetus that plays faster than God. You know what I mean?
Okay.
At what point is, I mean, who's the new guy that's going to give something new to the vocabulary? I'm looking towards that. I mean, I'm old. I'm kind of like, I'm still learning. I still love to practice and, you know, reinvent myself, you know, try to reinvent myself a little bit, you know, like, especially since I stopped partying and drinking and being a fool. I really, I'm back in the woodshed trying to find my way. I kind of lost my way for a minute, you know.
But you know, Steve,
disturbing after you keep doing the same thing over and over again.
I know many guitar players who structure their whole technique around Steve Lukather.
No, come on. What?
Honestly, really.
I'm really not the guy to copy. I mean, I'm still a humble student myself.
I think your playing is one of a kind on the universe, and always has been one of a kind.
Well, everybody's one of a kind. I mean,
yes,
I mean, you have to understand that everybody has. I mean, here's the perfect example. You give a room full of guitar players, the same guitar, and the same amp, the same chord, and tell them to play the same blues, right? You're gonna get, you know, 12 different versions of the same, everybody has their own signature thing.
Yes.
There's no trick, magic guitar, magic amp, or magic pedal. They enhance things and they help, but that's a myth.
Yeah.
I think it's, you can't jump over the fence and get from A to Z without doing all the middle, which is the long-term commitment to be a real musician, and you go to your grave with that.
Yes, but your there's loads of these guitar players that can really wind it along the neck and do.
Well, you know, that's, see, I, you know, the trappings of that is like, you know, it's like when I first heard Ed, everybody wanted to figure out what that was. So you jump and you find out what the trick is, and then you try to permutate it in some way that you can use it, so it doesn't sound exactly like you're copying. But now the technique has gotten so ridiculous. I mean, and I got, you know, every guitar player gets, I got sucked into that because I never really fit into any particular genre. Too jazz for rock, too rock for jazz. I play pop music, I play funk music, did all the Quincy stuff, and all that. All those records, do country sessions, and, you know, I can jam with anybody.
But you play from the soul, Steve.
Well, I try, but, you know, when I was drinking heavy, I'd play too much, and I'd just make a fool of myself, and there's brutal YouTubes, and, you know, people have no problem telling me that I suck. And, but there's a lot of shit on there that was never meant for public consumption.
No.
You know, after 12 tequilas, you get up and jam with somebody, never thinking that somebody's going to film it. And 10 years, 15 years, 25 years later.
Somebody did that?
Yo, every day in my life. Oh, no. I have, I'm like, you know, okay, you know, please forgive me, you know, for a bad night, you know.
Yeah.
I mean,
we're
you know.
Human,
but, you know, like I said, you know, it was a little come to Jesus for me, but, you know, it's okay. You know, I'm like, I make mistakes. I'm,
everybody makes mistakes.
So, you know, like I said, like I'm pretty well thought out in the studio live. I was a little bit more reckless. But now it's like I'm starting to find my muse again. You know, it's really important. After you've been playing so long and done so many things, it's like, well, there's so many incredible guitar players out there. I mean, absolutely jaw-dropping.
Yes.
Where do I fit into all this? It's like, oh my God, okay. I got my little thing that I do, and if you like it, great. If you don't, there's a lot of guys out there better than me. But, you know, that's not an issue. It's just trying to find your own voice. I mean, if you have your own voice, I suppose that's about the best thing you can hope for. Because there's always going to be somebody better and faster and younger and whatever. You know?
It keeps you going, though.
Yeah, I mean, I enjoy a little. I get excited about young players, man. You know, there's some really great guys out there, man.
Is there any of your young players, music generation wise, that you'd like to work with?
Well, you mean guitar player wise, or
yeah, anybody?
I don't know. I mean, I can. There's some great young bands. I mean, they're like Phoenix is a great band. I really think what they do is really interesting. I don't know how young they are, but as far as age, but you know, Arcade Fire, they've got some really interesting stuff. I've always been a Radiohead fan. I mean, it's not really flashy stuff, it's really interesting, really colorful stuff, you know. I mean, I like, I listen to beboppers. There's some great, I saw some young kid on YouTube. These people send me stuff. It's on the Facebook. I don't even remember these guys' names. There's a bebopper kid that was playing with, who was it, Borelli?
Okay.
You know, the French guy, and then the jazz bebopper. There's this young kid that just tore him a new asshole, man. It was like, wow, really playing? And he owned it. It was like, you just go, wow. That's deep. Because there's not a lot of young people keeping the jazz, the pure jazz thing alive. You know? You got... John Pizzarelli, and so I don't know how old he is. I know his dad, Bucky, because he was a. That's a long story. But anyway, I'm a fan of all that stuff. I really love Russ Malone, you know, like he plays with Diana Krall. You know, I listen to really interesting, weird stuff. I still go back to my old Miles and Herbie and Wayne Shorter stuff, you know. But, you know, but I can also get into the new Slipknot record, too, you know. Those guys are intense, man. Intense. And I mean, I dig it. I the intensity and commitment to what they do is just incredible. The energy level, you know. But, you know, like I said, I'm a fan of all genres. I mean, there's so many great country guys are stupid good, you know. I mean, amazing musicians.
Let's talk about your new records.
Oh, okay.
All well, the end's well.
Yes, the metaphor of it all.
Yes. Tell me about Brody's.
Oh, Brody's. I wrote that with my friend Randy Goodrum. In Nashville, we were in Nashville, and there's this, we kind of created this place and this character, you know, just kind of a character of the city. You know, we live in this blogging world, you know, everybody's an expert on nothing. You know, they have all, you know, there's these guys that, you know, everybody's a critic now, you know what I mean? There used to be one guy in every country, every town that would thumbs up or thumbs down. Now everybody, those people don't even matter anymore. It's your fans that are the hardest, you know, the people that come and pay their hard-earned money. They want to see the best you can be. And that's where I'm really, those are the people that matter to me. You know? But, wow, you know, it's overwhelming, really, the whole deal.
But
my record is just really very autobiographical. I mean, I wrote it from the heart. I wanted to get back into substance as opposed to flash. I mean, there's a couple of, one of the flashier moments on the record I was just doing as a warm-up. Which is Can't Look Back, right?
It's what a song.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and I was just warming up because I was really consciously going anti-fast.
Yes.
Because I unwittingly realized, like, whenever I would be nervous or drunk, I'd play too much and be ridiculous. And so I'm really like, I'm not doing that anymore. In any of it, you know. I'm not, you know, and then I was just warming up. My son came into the studio, and he's going, "Dad, you got to do that. That's incredible, Pop. You got to put that in." I go, "Oh no, that's ridiculous." So I laid down a couple of passes. I said, "I'm going to come back tomorrow and like got something to say." That's just kind of like full shred all.
Yeah.
And so Steve McMillan, the guy I was working with, he says, "Just go home and make put one together." Yeah, do put a couple of tapes. I said, "Well, just make it so it sounds like it's music, okay? Not just ranking." And what he put together is what's on the record. And I just kept going, "Geez, I don't know about this." And I played it for a couple of friends. Phil Collin, you know, he sang backgrounds on a couple of things when we're all friends. He showed up, and I played it for him. I go, "Do you think this is too much?" He goes, "No, man, it's great. You should get my son." Everybody's like,
yeah.
I kept going, "No." Because most of the rest of the stuff, I really showed some restraint, trying to play some interesting notes that are just outside of the box of a regular rock or blues kind of player.
It's a nice mix.
I also got that Larry Carlton school of thought. You know, I learned so much working with him and working with Rit and all the rest of the guys from that studio jazz rock crossover thing.
It's so tasteful, that album. It's just really, really tasteful.
I appreciate you saying
that. I was trying to work out how to describe it, but what I came up with was, it's like a box of chocolates, of all your favorite chocolates.
Yes.
And you get home and you sit down and you can eat them, and they're just all so wonderful. I can't put my finger on any one that I like the most, but they're just all great.
Thank you very much.
They really are. They're really...
That's a gem album.
Yeah.
Well, thanks a lot, man. I mean, it's nice to get, it's been received rather well, and you know, it's doing really well for me, you know, and you know, my record company Mascot's been incredible. Their support has been more than I've had in decades, so I'm really excited about to be on the road. I feel great, got a great band, and the tour's been going great, and I'm very lucky to be in this position to be able to do this after all these years. It's not like I'm flavor of the month, or I got a new hit record on the charts or something. I'm trying to be, hey, here I am. Us old school guys are getting a little bit more love than we used to get, because it was great, because I was talking to them. You know, the Journey guys busted open again with the, you know, with the TV show and all the song "Don't Stop Believing." I mean, we've all been friends. I mean, Neil's kids and my kids are friends, and you know, we all. It's just nice because the stigma that was attached to that genre of music, like the Journeys, Totos, and all that stuff, like we all got lumped in this box. Even though, if you put us listening to the record side by side, we don't sound anything alike. I think it was just an era, like genre stamp. Yes. Critics hate this kind of music if it comes from these kind of people. And it's really ridiculous. We're all friends. We're all very, like, you know, we've all worked in various configurations, whether even if it's just on the same concert or we've worked on records together. We're all friends, man. I mean, I love those guys. All of them. All those bands. We're all connected in one way or another. But they busted open, and that kind of opened the door for everybody else, too. Like, all of a sudden, like, Toto had broken up, and then we got back together again to help our brother Mike Picaro, who's got ALS, and it's really brutal. And, you know, just to see another brother from the same family, it's heartbreaking. But it's my bro, and Paige called me and said, "Let's do it again. Let's go out and just you know, just a little bit. We're not going to reform or do new records and all that stuff. Yeah. Let's go out and play the hits, what people want to hear." And all of a sudden, Journey busts open. All of a sudden, we're doing multiple nights sold out in arenas. We'll go out for 6-8 weeks over the course of a year, because most guys don't want to tour and jump on the rat wheel of tour, you know, record tour. Whereas I'm an animal. I mean, I just want to work. You know, I've always been that guy, which is why I did solo records in the first place, because I just never wanted to stop.
Yeah. I mean, just doing this tour, you're starting from the north of Europe, and you're working your way all the way
back. Oh, man, if you saw some of the schedules were brutal. But you know what? I enjoy it. I love the people I'm traveling with, so it's okay. Yeah. I'd rather be on a bus than at the airport anytime.
Oh, yes.
I got my bunk, I got my TV, I got my groove, you know, I got my hang, you know, I can sleep, I practice, I can do whatever I want to do, and I don't have to deal with, you know, people sticking their fingers up my ass looking for things that aren't there, you know, at the airport, you know, the TSA people. These rules are so ridiculous. Yes. Now, for guys like me that travel, like, all the time, you really see the flaws in all of it.
Yes.
Like, why are they doing this? What is this really? Have they caught anybody yet? Not really.
No.
Certainly not some old lady they're shaking down in a wheelchair. You know what I mean? It's like, come on, man. Chasing after all the wrong people. But anyway, I digress. But, you know, I've had a really interesting journey. I, like, blinked, and all of a sudden, 35 years went by.
Yes.
I know I'm 53, but I still think inside of my soul, I don't think the soul really moves. Gets older.
No.
The flesh does. And you can't help that. Everybody's doing that. I've been dyeing my hair since I was 25 years old. So, I mean, that's, you know. But, you know, but I mean, it's through the hair is real, you know. But, you know, I just, this is one of my life. This is my life. And it's only, you know, because I get a really cool job and I love my work, maybe it's not like I'm waiting for pension day where I can just pack it in and sit around and drink beer until I drop, you know. I really love my work. I'm kind of reinvigorated into it now that I'm concentrating my spare time not at the bar, but in playing and writing and being a good dad, you know, to my kids. I'm single again, so I don't know where that's going to lead me, but I'm friends with my ex, and you know, I mean, I don't want to leave any bad feelings anywhere. I've tried to apologize to people I may have wronged along the way. I'm not a mean, horrible person. I've done some stupid shit, but we all have. And I certainly, my sense of humor can really be misconstrued, you know. I'm very sarcastic and self-deprecating, and I've mouthed off about things that I really wish I hadn't, and I apologize to that, but finding my own way back, you know what I mean?
Yeah. We can hear from your albums how they're kind of not going away from the Toto sound, but they sort of, it's like a breakout.
Well, you know,
it's like,
I mean,
Steve Lukather, real personality coming out.
Well, thanks. I mean, I appreciate it. I mean, I've learned a lot from working with the guys that I grew up with, you know, and all the other great artists and producers and engineers that I've worked with over the years. And there's a lot of vast amount of people in every style that I can think of, but I'm still trying to find it, man. It's like In Search of the Lost Note, you know what I mean? There's how many, you can play the same things, but it's how do you make it new?
Yes.
You know what I mean? The blues scale is the blues scale. Yes. How do you make that interesting, where you're not just repetitive over and over again? I mean, it's a part of everybody's vocabulary. But I was just listening to Joe Bonamassa's new record, who I love. I love Joe. He's a friend, too, but I just think we're on the same label. Just love his shit, you know? And he's got a fresh approach to it, you know? And very much, he's a much younger cat, but, you know, his soul sounds old, you know? I mean, he's a great voice, too. Yeah. But anyway, you know, it's like, you know, there's a lot of people that I go, okay, he's doing it in a different way. And, you know, I learned from a lot of anybody. I can just dig, you know, just a Keith Richards tuning can, like, open up a whole new vocabulary for it. Just somebody just try this. Yeah. Try this. You know, tune your guitar different. Do something different, and you'll fall on your own play. You'll find some new stuff to play.
Yes. But I can hear from your playing that you come from a self-taught background that's gradually evolved into...
Yeah, I learned how to play and then kind of went through realized it hit a certain wall. You know, I want to learn more. If I'm going to get into the studio thing, then I have to learn how to read. I was at that age, we all were, you know, that we were voraciously studying, trying to learn everything we could. And then using what we learned on a gig or in practical application.
You know? Well, all that hard work really paid off, didn't it? Because
it worked out for me, man. Yeah. I mean, knock wood. I mean, I'm still working after all these years. Yeah. I've never been out of work, so I'm really blessed in this day and age where a lot of guys are just staring at the telephone going, ring,
come on,
please ring. You know, because I mean, the machines, I remember when the machines started to take over, you know. I was with Roger Lynn, who ironically was Leon Russell's guitar player.
Yes.
And you know, he's living with some high school friends, and he put together the first drum machine. And we heard it. I was sitting in the room with Jeff Picaro, Steve Picaro, and myself. And he made it work. He went, doom, spanks, doom, doom, bass, doom, bass. I thought Jeff Picaro was going to lose his mind. He goes, I'm going to take this thing, I'm going to strap it to my back, jump in the pool, and destroy it. This thing's going to ruin the music business. And Roger would start laughing. He goes, no, it's not meant to do that. He goes, look, you don't even know what's going to happen. And then all of a sudden they figured out how to do the drum machine, synced up to a synthesizer clock, hence you have the 80s synth pop.
That's it. Yeah.
And, you know, that, you know, and then we were always in the middle of, like, we were just coming out of the 70s. Like, you know, our record comes out, and then just as we were getting our, like, you know, prog rock was really happening, we were all into all that music, and we were trying to figure out where we fit into all that, trying to make a rock, more rock approach to that, but still be commercial, like a more little heavier Steely Dan, you know what I mean? A little louder, more obnoxious guitar parts for me. And then all of a sudden punk hit, you know? And it was like, oh, then all of a sudden, then they hated us, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, I always hated the name Toto anyway. Yeah. I tried, our high school band was Still Life. I thought that should have been our name.
Still Life.
Yeah, I thought that was a cooler name. But Jeff and Dave were like, nah, we gotta, like, guys, we're gonna get killed if we do this.
Yeah.
But I was the teenage member at the time, so I'm like, okay, guys, I just wanna play with y'all, whatever. And here I am 35 years later.
Well,
you know
I have to keep smacking myself on the cheek here because when I was 17, 18, you know, I used to have a little Ford Escort and I used to go racing to the beach with a surfboard on the roof.
Cool.
and St. George and the Dragon playing on the and that solo at the end, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. I used to rewind that and play that over and over and over.
And you stretched the tape, I bet you did.
Wow, the A-track, right?
So that, everyone...
I've been around so long, there are records around on A-track, right?
But you're still here, which is a good thing.
Yes. Yeah. Well, you know, like I said, you know, that's another thing. A lot of my friends either passed away or sick. Party years have caught up, and a lot of my guitar player buddies, we didn't have a secret meeting or nothing like that, but everybody kind of said, okay, that's it. I could name 12 of some of the most famous of them that are all friends. We're all friends.
Yeah,
but we all run into each other now. It's like, nah, no mas, man. Yeah, me too. Yeah. Yeah, I think we all drank the bar, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, it starts out in innocent fun, but like I said, if every night, Saturday night, people come to a gig, it's their night out, the woo. But I used to go out and hang with everybody, and then everybody buy you drinks, and the next thing you know, they're hauling me off to bed. And not a good look when you're in your 50s, you know what I mean? And it was affecting my playing, the way I looked, the way I felt. I was really miserable in my personal life, so I was drowning that. Mm. And there's a lot of issues in my life that I'm not going to get into now, but I didn't, you know, I'm better now.
Yeah. Great.
Yeah. I'm trying my damnedest, all right? I love the guitar. I love playing. I get a lot of shit out on this beautiful instrument that God has given me. It's a wonderful opportunity. I don't want to squander it.
I
lost my way a moment there. I'm sorry. I apologize.
You said that the record now is lyrically dark.
Well, my life was dark. I was write about what you feel. I'm not going to write about somebody's big ass at the club right now, am I? You know what I mean? You know what I mean? It's really got nothing to say about that at this point. I don't go to the club. But, you write about what's on your mind, you know, and I was trying to be honest, and lyrically speaking, that was always a weaker point of things. I wanted to be honest. I mean, I'll never be Bob Dylan, wish I was, but just write from your heart, and apparently people could relate to some of the things I was writing about. You know?
Really,
we'll figure honesty is always the best policy. Yeah. You know, so thanks.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Some of the sounds are heavier, and I like that heavier sound. Do you think you'll continue it if you do?
Well, I'm going to, you know, probably continue on the same path, but, you know, the road can go like this a little bit, you know. But I can't anticipate when I was talking to my record company president yesterday. He goes, well, when are you going to think about another record? I said, well, you know, this year is touring. So I would say probably I'll be in writing and in the studio by March, April next year. Mm-hmm. And working with a lot of CJ Vanston as my writing partner, and Randy, and my son's probably going to jump in and help on a few things. I love where he's coming from. Trev's a really talented kid, man. And, you know, it's really difficult for him because he's breaking into the music business, but there's no music business. To be with major labels, nah, you don't want to be on a major label. Those are the guys that crippled everything.
Yeah.
It wasn't Steve Jobs, as some people have mistakenly thought, which is, wow, man. You know, the internet's a scary thing. You say one thing, I've been really had my ass kicked by saying some off-the-cuff remark, you know, and then somebody runs with a soundbite taken out of context,
and then make it
fun. And it's like, no, I didn't mean it like that, but once it goes into cyberspace, man, it's like, you can't suck the air back. No, I didn't mean to say that, you know, please don't take that, I was just kidding, jeez. And then all of a sudden, that's the big, you know, there it is, and then you have to live that down, or if you do something stupid, or you say something stupid, it's on YouTube. I mean, the one thing that kills me, this is the thing. We look out in the audience, and this is what you see.
Yes.
Now, my favorite part of this whole exercise of going to a concert and everyone sticking their camera in your face, which, if you're the artist, is really unnerving, especially if you're doing improvisation.
Yes.
You try to get into the moment, all of a sudden, you might look up for a second, all of a sudden, people's like, big red light going.
Yeah.
Like this in your face, and you're like, and that throws out your concentration.
Yes.
But then they post on your Facebook, dig the video, dig what I got, and you press on it out of curiosity, and I really don't watch YouTubes of myself because I just can't. I only see flaws, and it kills me. But you it's like, why did you come to the show and not even dig the show? You were so busy worried about the fucking camera that you missed the whole thing.
Yes.
And it sounds like shit, so why bother?
Don't put it up. Just don't put it up.
You know, especially when the God said, would you mind not doing that, and people do it anyway. Or they try to, like, well. It's like, you know, it's cause some people don't bother. I mean, like, the jam band guys embraced all this stuff way back when, but still, you end up with 90% of the stuff is really amateur hour.
Yeah.
And then it's like the guy walking through Disneyland with his kids with the camera.
Yeah.
Mike, he's here with the kids, and he's gonna, but he misses the whole experience because he's too worried about what's going on. He's carrying this around. I go, fuck. I mean, I went through this with my older kids.
Yeah.
You know, I. Yeah. Cool. You know, people. I mean, and these little boxes are great. We're all addicted to them. Yeah. Guilty computers. It used to be work when we caught blow. Yeah. Now it's are we online?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You know, that's all the decades have changed.
Yes.
Exactly. So
yes.
Yeah. Every time I have sex, I hear that.
That's Steve's sense of humor, man.
Yeah.
I know.
That is his sense of humor.
I can't help it. My mother dropped me on my head when I was young. That's what she used to say, anyway. God bless her soul. She used to come to the club. We used to jam at the Baked Potato. That was my local hang, my local pub. It still actually is. A great, great jam place. My mom would come every once in a while and see us play, and I'd mouth off some stupid shit over the microphone. And at the end, everybody go like, his mom's a fuck, you know. And at the end of the massage, she goes, you know, I dropped him on his head when he was young.
Oh, dear.
So, I mean, yeah, Mom, I take it way out in front of him. I never edited my material for any of my kids or nothing, and they all turned out.
Yes.
I'm just joking around. People don't understand that, then I apologize.
Yeah. I think we should know you by now.
Yeah, no, well, not necessarily. There's a lot of things about me that aren't true. But
yeah.
That's the thing about Facebook. I mean, my son got me into all this. I'm very much involved in it, and that really is me on the Facebook page. I really do.
Brilliant.
I don't have a PR person doing this or nothing. I have a lot of time in a hotel room when I get, they dump me off at 7 o'clock in the morning in some hotel, and I'm online. There's nothing on TV that's really of interest to me. The news, boy, is pretty depressing.
Yes.
You turn it on just to find out what's going on. You go, oh, God, okay. Pray for the world, and then I find it very relaxing.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much. That's a good idea. You suck. Delete. It's like, okay, you know, whatever. People waste their time. Look at that mistake. 1:43. It's like, oh, Lord, man. Do you really have a life?
Yeah.
You know, every great musician I've ever heard has made a mistake or two.
Oh, yeah.
Played a tune, sang a note out of tune. There's some shit out there where, like, the monitors went out on me. I had no monitors at all, and I'm singing a little out of tune.
Yeah.
And cats go, this guy sucks. Cats, but they don't. There's no like explanation why.
No.
They just make up.
No
and then
idea.
You suck because you made a mistake.
Yeah.
And you can't take it off. You try to go, dude, can you take that now? My webmaster Aaron is like, I gotta get this guy to take this shit off.
Yeah.
And some people will, some people don't.
Yeah.
You know, they like the fact they have something bad on you.
I know.
It's like, come on, guys. Yeah. There's 850 versions of that tune. Why do you have to use that?
So what can we expect from the show tomorrow?
I'm going to be performing the Archie's first album, Completely Naked. I thought that would be interesting.
New twist.
No.
That'd be cool. That would be so cool, wouldn't it?
I don't know, did the Archie's ever make, I mean, I'm really dating myself. It's like some really bad prefab, fake bubblegum music from the 60s. Okay. For anybody that cares to what that reference is all about. No, I do stuff from all the solo stuff, all the solo records. I throw in a couple of deep cuts from my old band, but I don't do anything obvious. You know. There still is a Toto in existence that will come back and play the hits properly played.
Yes.
I don't believe in doing karaoke versions of things that require the real guys to make it sound the real way.
Yes.
There are other people that have been in the band that have gone out and done it and to not so successful endings, but I don't wish anybody any harm or anything like that, but that's not what I've been doing solo records for 22 years, so
yeah.
I've kind of cultivated an audience that's outside of that Toto box.
Yes.
Some people, the crossover, can they come to both, and some people just kind of like prefer what I do, or they'd rather go see Toto and not me, or vice versa.
Yeah.
I just do what I do, you know, I mean, there's a lot of playing, but I've got 8 or 9 albums to choose material from, and then I just throw something interesting in there, an interesting cover once in a while, and do something. I let everybody play a lot.
Yeah.
It's fun, you know. So I mean, you have to come dig it. See,
yes,
I mean, obviously
yes.
I do stuff for the new album, but you know, all my solo stuff, all solo albums.
Any power techniques or dance routines you're gonna do
after the show?
Okay, that's fine.
You guys gotta come. I mean, we've been getting, you know, it's been going down really, really well every night. So, I mean, people seem to be I get the reviews. The people tell the truth. Because, like, on Twitter and stuff like that, if somebody says you suck, it comes up. Whenever your name is mentioned in something, it comes up.
Yeah.
So, I mean, like, it's not like I only get the good reviews, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I haven't seen anything bad. Somebody gave me some shit about a YouTube that was out, I sang out of tune because I had no monitors. But there was no explanation about that. So yeah. I'm like, okay, I mean, you write the guy back on, look, dude, I didn't have any monitors. But, you know, hey, if you don't dig it, I'm sorry. But most of this has been incredibly positive, you know, so. And an extremely young audience, which is really wild to me. I'm really thankful. And even girls are showing them now. You know, when I used to do the heavy fusion shit, it's like, it's truly like a prison tour where there's only men in the audience, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, I'm not your oldest fan, and I'm not your youngest fan, but I'm definitely the newest fan.
I love it. Thank you. That was very nice. Very cool. Very
cool. Yeah. As you were talking about your playing and how you get things to sound a certain way, and to sound differently, there's a track on the album called The Truth.
Well, that was the last album, yeah.
The last album, yes, yes.
That was a piano. I wrote that as a piano piece.
Really?
Yeah, I wrote it for my grandmother.
Absolutely beautiful, you know?
And yeah, I had it lying around for a long time, and I just never found a home for it. I said, well, instead of a piano piece, it was rather movie soundtrack-ish.
Yes.
I said, what if I did it, and I asked my buddy Steve Lukather, I said, would you orchestrate this for me?
Yeah.
Because he's got like the whole orchestra at his fingertips thing, because he does a lot of film and television scores. And, you know, one of my oldest best friends, too. And so I said, I have this piece, and I went over to his house, and I played it as a piano piece, because I play piano, too. And I go, okay, so take the melody out.
Yeah.
And I'm going to do this as a guitar piece, a solo guitar piece.
Yeah.
There's one of my favorite guitar players in the world, Jeff Beck, you know. And, you know, it's sort of a little nod there, but
yeah.
I just played the melody like the way I wrote it.
Yes.
But instead of a piano piece, I played it as a guitar piece.
Absolutely beautiful.
So I gotta give Steve props for making me sound, putting all that wonderful, lush orchestration around a simple melody.
But that song will stand on its own without that orchestration. It's one of those kind of songs.
Really? Well, thanks.
Yeah.
Appreciate
it. If you played it with your band right now, it would still sound awesome.
Oh, well, you know, I mean, I may add that next, you know, like I said, the joys of having a long career and it's been going so well is that I can come back and do it again. I try not to do the same song.
Okay.
You know what I mean? I try, you know, it's not like I have to do Africa or Hold the Line every night, which I would have to do on a Toto show.
Okay.
That's part of the reason why I jumped on this whole solo thing in the first place, was to be able to have another outlet
to do other things.
And now it's like, now when we get back together with the old guys, my old friends, it's like going to summer camp with my high school buddies.
Yeah.
We go out and have a laugh, we enjoy ourselves, we enjoy the company, and we play our hearts out.
Yeah.
And I look around the stage and go, those are the guys that I started. Yeah, there's Paige, there's Steve, there's
working.
And now it's fun again.
Yeah.
And it wasn't fun at the end, and that's so I put an end to it.
Yeah.
And now now I can feel like that when we come back to it. You know what I mean?
Brilliant. Brilliant.
These guys must have some money on the game.
Probably.
The old Toto lottery.
Is it football?
It's cricket.
Cricket.
England won.
Oh, right.
That's why there's the noise.
Oh, right.
Well, they won the game. Okay. Yeah, they're not out of the series.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I can see.
Is that your local team?
English team.
Oh, see, there you go.
Yeah.
Give everybody a chance to party even more than they already gonna anyway.
We're gonna celebrate tonight.
Are you guys gonna get shit faced tonight? Come on.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, you are.
I didn't drink. And you're driving anyway.
Yes.
Yes. No.
Well, when you get home.
Yes. Yeah. I'll have one for Steve.
You have several for me. See, I'm just because I don't. I don't care. Please do.
Yeah.
I'll buy people drinks and drive them home.
Oh, okay.
My older kids are like, you know, 25 and 23 now, so I just say, I'll drive, man, party on.
Yeah,
I'm not like, I don't belong to any AA programs or anything. I just, for, like I said, for health reasons, I just, for my life, and for my playing, and for everything.
Yeah.
I did a complete restart of my whole life. I unplugged myself and plugged myself back in. Okay, let's remove all the bullshit from my life and all the toxins, and let me get back into what is my life all about? So I changed everything in my life, consequently, ended up by myself, really having to take a hard look.
Yes.
And I found my passion for the instrument again.
Yeah.
It's so like, good. You know, I mean, I've always been so busy my whole life that, you know, I wanted to, what is it all about? You get to that age where you're like, what's it all about, Alfie? Yeah. Well, you know what I mean?
Yes, yes.
And try to right some wrongs, and I'm feeling good. I'm really, 7 weeks on the road, and I'm still like, yeah, I'm not all like,
No.
Yeah, fuck.
Yeah.
But you know, eons of hangovers. I just don't have that anymore. So mm-hmm. I have all this extra energy, and I'm focusing in a positive way.
Yeah.
Oh, but if you want to party, please do. If you're young, yeah. Just don't drive the car and kill anybody. You know?
Well, we can walk back from the gig anyway.
What guitar are you playing?
Music Man, man. Music Man, Luke Guitar. It's what I've been playing for 20-some-odd years. We have, we're working on a new version of it. You know, we have the old school one with the Floyd, and then the new school one, which doesn't have that. And then we got, there's always, you know, what can we do differently? So we're working on a new 3 model. It would seem a little different. A different presentation, a little different body, a little different neck thing, and maybe some different pickups. Always got to keep moving forward. You know, there'll always be the regular one that sits there. Yes. Like, you know, would you like this version of that? Or is like a Tele or a Strat?
Yes.
They're both Fenders, yes. You know, but.
Slight tweaking.
Yeah, it just has a little different twist to it.
Yes. Because you do play different guitars through the night. Is that just a
they're trick? They're all my model. You know, there's some have a different pickup in it, or some different, or just older school, so different colors, really. You know, just kind of like, or different tunings.
Yes, of course. You know? Yes.
I'm not really going crazy with the tunings on this leg. Sometimes down a half step on older records that I did. It has a little darker sound to it.
Yes.
The drop D tuning on something, you know. But mostly, I'm not doing the Jimmy Page crazy tunings.
Okay.
Although, I want to spend some time with that. I want to get into some, because it definitely sparks new ideas. I always loved all the old Genesis records and the stuff that Steve Hackett and Mark Rutherford come up with, these great acoustic parts and open tunings and interesting capoed stuff, you know, and Jimmy Page was the master of creating all those interesting voicings that, you know, even Keith Richards with his G-tuning, I mean, you know, once you learn that trick and you start playing this thing, you go, oh, there's that, and now it sounds right. And yeah, I just read his book, it's a great book. And you know, the story about that, why you know, people play these songs and they play them wrong. It's like Smoke on the Water.
Yes.
Most people play that wrong. They play the fifths. It's all fourths.
Yeah.
Which I didn't really realize because, you know, it's one of those kind of things you hear in the periphery in the back of your head.
Oh, that's right.
Like I was doing, at one point I was playing Shine On You Crazy Diamond during my set because I did a cover version for a tribute record. You know, and Dave Gilmore is one of my fan heroes. And he's also a friend. And I realized that I was playing the thing wrong. Yeah, boom, bam, bam.
Oh, yes. That bit, yeah.
You know, but what I was just doing like the in key of G, B flat, you know, I was doing F to E, but I didn't move the F up to the G. So I was just doing a minor sixth.
Yes.
Instead, but you're doing it, you're supposed to do the G, C, and I'm sorry out there. I know I fucked up. Should have listened to the record first before I cut that. But, you know, I mean, there's little things like that. It's just like you're in with Stones tunes. It's like, it's that. What you're doing is you're getting that sus against the third.
Yes.
And that's what gives that start me up, and you go, you know, and you got the sus on top. That's what makes it swing. I got a 51 Esquire that's just tuned to that. Whenever I want to hear that, that's what I pull out.
Oh, what's
there it is. You know, plug it through an Ampeg, and there you go.
I listened to an acoustic track version of 99 that you used to do.
Oh, really? Oh, I don't even remember doing that.
That's such beautiful.
Chord. I have really weird, chord. My memory thing is like, I do so much stuff. And maybe it's because when I was a studio musician, having to learn 4-5 tunes a day.
Might be
Georgie. In and out, remember it, forget it, remember it, forget it, you know, empty the hard drive.
I think it was Georgie Porgy.
Might have been.
Yeah,
we used to do little medleys of all the old tunes.
Lovely, lovely chord voicing.
David Petro, great chord changes. David, I learned a lot about writing from David. Brilliant writer. Always could put adult chords into pop music. So I'm kind of taking that with the new records. I'm going to try and sneak not obvious chord changes into like what would be deemed pop music or accessible music. I might try to write fusion or, you know, heavy fusion music. I mean, I like that stuff, but I mean, those one more tune with A minor, F, C, G, I'm going to shoot with those. I mean, come on, guys. You know, wasn't that tired 30 years ago? You know?
Yes.
I mean, try to. What people, you know, I mean, you can take the melody and revoice it. That's what all the jazz guitar players do. They take a simple standard. Look at Joe Pass, and they. Or there, I've got this great Lenny Bro YouTube that I got sent. It was just. You could tell he's just on the cutting edge of all. And just for him, he's thinking in 5-part harmony all the time. You know, it's just brilliant to watch that. You go, God, that's when you really feel small as a musician. You go, wow, look at that guy. he's not mega famous, and this guy over here who struggles to play a bar chord is.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, it's just, nobody said life was fair.
No.
Yeah.
If life was fair, if you took the money out of the music business, I wonder who'd still be left. Only the real musicians.
Yes.
Because everybody wants to be a pop star, right? Anybody, you can be manufactured, like McDonald's hamburgers.
Yeah.
And that's what happens in a lot of times. I mean, the 10 to 20,000 hours that you hear about, that you had, that you're supposed to have at least 10,000 hours. It's more like 100,000 hours. I don't know how many hours can you put in a year to practice. Yeah. But you know, a lot of practice to get good enough to be able to do that. Yeah. Now it's just like, no, you're good enough. We'll take you. Well, don't worry, we can fix it with the computer. Wear these clothes, do this. Your spin. We're going to get you a new look, a new name, a new thing. We own you. Make you a pop star, and then we're done with you. We'll find another one. We'll take your place.
Oh man, that's so wrong.
I mean, people are disposable, like potato chips. Or something. Wow, really? Like producers are stars. We're okay, use my drum set, my amps, my people, my engineer, my sounds, my. I write the song, and it's like, well, who's the artist? All of a sudden, the artist gets lost in this cacophony of input.
Yes.
Just front. Just front page.
So I mean, I think people having long careers. I mean, how many people have? I'm just like almost in 35 years. Wow. And then people are really nice to me now that didn't used to be. You know, it's like, oh wow, you know. I remember Don Henley telling me years ago. See, hang around long enough, they'll change their mind. Because we were getting so brutalized early on in our career.
Yeah.
I was working with Don on his first solo album in 1980, and he said to me, keep these things. You know, we're still friends and stuff. He goes, what is it, man? He goes, wait, if you hang in there, if you can hang and take the punches.
Yes.
If you can show that you can take the punches, they'll respect you in the end. Yeah. Just for, if no other reason, still be in it.
Yeah.
I mean, my music may not be everybody's cup of tea, and that's fine. I mean, I don't like everything I hear either, but that doesn't mean it's not good. It just means I don't like mayonnaise either. People love them. You know what I mean? It's kryptonite for me, but people will bury themselves in it. They like it. You know what I mean? So, you know, music is very much like everybody has a food they don't care for. Yeah. They don't eat it.
Yeah.
Music is much the same.
Same, yes.
You know? Yes. I like chocolate cake, but not at every meal.
No. Just a bit every now and again.
Yeah, a little taste.
Yeah.
Are you coming back to the UK later in the year?
Some
charity stuff?
We're looking at them. This is my first foray outside of the obvious places, and I'm looking forward to it very much because when I tell my jokes on stage, everybody will get them. Because I'm really kind of I like the humor aspect of it. There's so many brooding, overly serious players. I mean, you know, I understand in the context of a serious piece of music to be serious, but, you know, in between banter and stuff like that, I mean, you know, we take the piss. You'll see tonight, I mean, we take the piss out of each other and have a laugh, you know. I'm the first guy to laugh at myself, and believe me, there's a lot to laugh at. But you know, I take the music part of it seriously, but I'm not afraid of public speaking, as you'll find out.
Yeah. Well, maybe when you come back, you'll come and have another chat with us.
Hell yeah, let's do that.
Yes.
All right, man. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
I'll see you tonight. You guys got sorted for passes and all that.
Yes, thank you very much.
I will see you guys later. Thank you. I'm gonna go get some food.